know whether he has accepted Islam or not by the time he died, because he was in coma for almost one day. And I went to him and prayed for him, and I told him what I really felt, that after Allah, if there is something that I really respect and love, is it was my dad, and it will always be, you know. And it is, of course, it's only because of the way that my father brought us up that we have really understood our Creator and, you know, come closer to Islam. But I request everyone to pray for my mother and my brother, who's still there, like, have not accepted Islam. They still know about Islam. They always say, pray for us. My brother always says, the brother in India, he always says, please pray for me and tell your children also to pray for me and all that. But unfortunately, he has not accepted Islam. Inshallah, Allah is the one who gives hidayah. And he will, inshallah. The point I wanted to say is how my parents came to know how I accepted Islam. We were living in a colony, about 200, 300 houses, and you won't believe, we were the first Muslims in that place. Me, my brother, and my sister were in fact, my brother was the first Muslim. And you know how gossip and how words go ahead. So first, we kept it a secret for quite a long time. But you know, people kept on saying that my brother's name is Vinod. Oh, Vinod's sister has accepted Islam. And you know, some Muslim friends started telling it to non-Muslims, and they came to know. And it was almost 2 years when my parents came to know that, you know, though we were living in the same house. By then, alhamdulillah, I had learnt a little bit of Islam. I used to go around 3-4 hours away. I used to bunk classes and go and learn how to pray. And learnt how to, I mean, little bit of Islam and little bit of Arabic through cassettes I used to learn. And alhamdulillah, I was a very good reader. So and my brother was there. And we had a very good Muslim friend, my brother's friend, who used to translate the Quran into a regional language, Kannada. And he used to, you know, come home, and we used to sit together at the dead of the night till after everyone sleeps and learn more about Islam. Every night it was like a great day for us. We used to learn and read new things about Islam. And it was, I feel, you know, I was more closer to Allah than how I feel now.
على كل مسلم أن يكون مرآة صافية لدينه، تجعل كل من ينظر إليها يأسره جمال وروعة هذا الدين، فيؤثر بنفوس الآخرين.
Yeah, of course, I have a message for my Muslims and non-Muslim brethren. With non-Muslims, I want them more to understand different religion, and not, you know, to understand who is your creator, purpose of your creation, and what you will get, whether you will get in this world or the hereafter. You have to compare the religions and understand what is the best religion that is there. And as for my Muslim brothers and sisters, I would request my Muslim sisters to be more into the propagation. You know, Islam has made it compulsory for a Muslim woman or man to propagate Islam. Dawah is compulsory, actually, for us. But you know, we see that, you know, most of us don't take it as an obligation and do dawah. For example, from the sacrifices of Sumayya, the way Khadijatul Kubra used to spend her wealth for the sake of Islam, from the learning and the compilation of hadith of Aisha, from how Ummu Sulaim called Abu Talha into Islam through marriage. She considered, you know, her dower as, you know, her mahar as Abu Talha's reversion into Islam. And Ummu Hakim, she used to, she was the person behind her husband accepting Islam. You can find lot of Sahabi women, peace be upon them all, who invited people to Islam, who guided and preached and, you know, taught people Islam. But we are seeing a lot of lack among our Muslim women. You know, Islam doesn't consider knowledge as secular and, you know, religious. Islam considers knowledge, whatever kind of knowledge, is important. And even if you have the knowledge of you don't need to be a scholar. Even if you know La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, that's enough to guide a person towards Islam. And another point I want to say is, lot of people who accept Islam, that is, who revert to Islam, I've seen, maybe I've not seen here, but in our country, in India, we have seen that they go back to their faith go back, return to their faith after coming to Islam. You know, because there are nobody to guide them, nobody to take care of them, nobody to counsel them, nobody to give them love and attention. You know, our Muslims, when a person goes away and goes back to their previous faith, leaving Islam, I think Islam is being challenged. I think non-Muslims will point a finger. And also, you know, Allah's wrath will be upon us about what we are not, why we are not helping them. You know, it's because of our community also. I remember a French convert who said, I would never have accepted Islam if I had seen Muslims before I had seen Islam. Muslims are not giving the right impression about Islam to others. Even a character should be a right dawah to call people to Islam. And Islam is compulsory on us. For me, I can understand the pain that non-Muslim family, my relatives, my grandmother is still alive. You know, my grandmother, my relatives who are not still Muslim. Imagine how painful it is to see your father or your relatives in a hell. You know, dawah is so, if everyone does his duty of doing dawah, then I'm sure that more and more people, and even my relatives, my friends, and everyone will accept Islam. And we will give them the beauty of this universal religion.
لا تكتمل السعادة إلا بالاستقرار، وهو سبب مهم يسعى إليه الناس. لذلك فقد كان الزواج سكن الزوجين للآخر، وهكذا فقد رزقت خديجة بسكن روحها، وذلك بتيسير الله رب العالمين من الرحمن المنان.
You remember I told you that when I accepted Islam, the only point I told my brother is, please don't force me into marriage. So, you know, my brother was very, you know, he knew that, you know, once I'm convinced, like I was convinced about religion, I would not say no. And he knew that by the time it was 2 years, I had known like it is compulsory, it's Rasulullah's part of Sunnah that a person gets married. And so, you know, before I had even spoken to him, he had already, immediately after I accepted Islam, there was at least my brother got 2 or 3 proposals from people. You know, especially this, we had gone to a mosque inaugural in a different place, and me and my brother, and there we met, we had some friends, and so I was staying in the friend's house, and my brother was meeting all the group. You know, and when my brother was meeting them, he just told them, this friend told the others, see, Vinod's sister has accepted Islam. Now we have to find a guy for him. Though I had told no. And he told him that. And then my brother, my husband and all the others were sitting. And my husband immediately said, I will accept her. I will marry her. So, and then, you know, my brother and he kept corresponding between each other. And my husband wrote a letter to his family. So I have decided to marry this girl who has accepted Islam and I want to marry her. He didn't even ask for his parents' decision. But mashallah, my husband's family is very religious. His father immediately came to my husband was staying in the hostel and studying for his B-Farm. And my father-in-law immediately came and told the friend's father that no problem, bring her. You just get her out of their house and I'm ready to accept her. So my husband's family is very, very religious. And mashallah, my husband is also. And now alhamdulillah, and after 2 years, after 3 years after I accepted Islam, my brother had got a job in Saudi Arabia and he wanted to go away. You know, he had to support 2 sisters. And if we were sent out of the house, of course, my parents didn't do that. And my parents, you know, got us. He said that there is a guy for our daughter, so let's get her married. So my parents went and visited my husband in some hotel, and they liked my husband. Alhamdulillah. But you know, the point is, like, we had to face a lot of. That was the time when my father used to keep us under house arrest, and I remember my relatives and my uncles came and told me, we can give you anything in this world, don't get married. Even the day before my nikah, they came and told me, we can give you anything in this world, don't get married to a Muslim. You know, but most of the relatives, my father had told them that it was love. When I had not even seen my husband, even before the day before my marriage, only after my nikah, I'm seeing my husband for the first time. He came to see me and I said, you know, I don't don't want to see my husband because I feel, you know, anybody, I don't mind marrying a blind man or a handicapped man as far as he's a Muslim. So that was the faith that we had at that time. Alhamdulillah, it's all Allah's grace that He has given me a good husband who's not blind, who's not handicapped. That was Allah's faith, this one. And Alhamdulillah, I have four children now, two boys and two girls who are twins.